next Sunday is Pentecost. Between those liturgical milestones, this week we celebrate the Ascension. Christians confess that Jesus came down to earth in the Incarnation, according to last week's epistle from 1 Peter 3. And the Apostles' Creed, he went down even further. And now this week, Jesus goes up to heaven in the Ascension. Finally, after Jesus goes up in the Ascension, next Sunday the Holy Spirit will come down on the believers at Pentecost. Confused yet? I'm working on it. These central affirmations of the Christian faith require us to consider our ancient religious texts in ways that honour our modern scientific cosmologies. Cosmologies is the scientific study of the origin, evolution, and eventual fate of the universe. So that's much to keep repeating. So how should we understand this language of ascent and descent? Is it metaphorical or literal, fictional or mythical? Some mix of those, or maybe something altogether different. Matthew and Mark don't mention the ascension, except in Mark's longer ending. They seem to construe the resurrection, ascension, exaltation of Jesus as a single and singular event. There are several oblique references to the Ascension in John. Luke does something different. In his Gospel and in Acts, he separates the resurrection and the Ascension. He writes that 40 days after his resurrection, Jesus was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. And so he was taken from them into heaven. The Ascension grapples with an important and perplexing ambiguity faced by the earliest believers. In what sense was Jesus now both present and absent after his death and resurrection? Luke's version of the Ascension would have addressed an obvious problem that rose in those early days. Continuing claims of further resurrection appearances, some of them legitimate and many of them spurious. Jesus' definitive ascension 40 days after his resurrection would have put a strict limit on such claims. In addition to Luke, there are another 20 or so references that allude to the ascension. By the late 2nd century and down to our own day, in most churches around the world, every Sunday, we Christians confess the ascension in the Apostles' Creed. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. St. Augustine, who died in 430, wrote that the Feast of the Ascension was widely observed long before his time. Art and architecture also honoured the Ascension. By 384, an exact place on the Mount of Olives was venerated. In 390, a wealthy Roman woman named Poemenia financed the construction of the chapel of the Ascension. I have to believe that because of the scratching around. I found photographs of it taken 2 years ago, so it's still there, complete with a footprint. In our ancient texts, our creeds and conventions, and in our art and architecture, from Syrian illuminated manuscripts to Danish wall paintings, Christians have professed our belief in the Ascension. But how are we to understand it? The painting of the Ascension by the Italian Andrea Mantega that contrasts heaven above and earth below, with Jesus hovering in between, surrounded by winged angels. Is that what really happened? Is that what it looked like and what we now confess? A controversial Jesus seminar, 1985 to 2006, rejected the Ascension as a literary fiction. Skeptics dismissed it as an embarrassing example of a pre-critical cosmology. Literalist interpretations make the sacred story sound a bit imaginative. What we accept or understand rather depends on how we regard the evolution of human knowledge of the universe and where our world fits within. But now try this thought experiment. what will today's cosmologies science study look like 2,000 years from now, or even a mere 100 years from now? A few years ago, the astrophysicist Mario Livio wrote a book with the marvellous title, imagine writing this down in your notes of the pictures. The title is Brilliant Blunders from Darwin to Einstein, Colossal Mistakes by Great Scientists that Changed Our Understanding of Life and Universe, written in 2013. It's misleading to apply credibility to any cosmology, whether ancient or modern, as a fixed and final view of the world for all time. That's just not how science works. What we accept or understand rather depends on how we regard the evolution of human knowledge of the universe and where our world fits within it. In his book, The Big Questions in Science and Religion, the Oxford theologian and ordained Anglican priest Keith Ward captures the clash of ancient and modern cosmologies of scientific study that we experience with the Ascension story. He writes, "We know that if Jesus began ascending 2,000 years ago, he would not yet have left the Milky Way unless he attained warp speed. And we all know what warp speed is, don't we? We've watched Star Trek. You've gone." See, I shouldn't do that, lost the words. To state the obvious, our ideas today about space and time are different from those in Luke's day. Paul described a three-tier universe in Philippians. In heaven and on earth and under the earth, it's tempting and condescending to disparage this outmoded cosmology of Jesus' day by contrasting it with the updated cosmologies of contemporary physics. But this isn't as easy as it sounds, nor does it help that much. Luke or Paul could not have known our modern cosmologies. They believed the best cosmology of their day. Ptolemy's geocentric view of the world, which reigned for 1,000 years as the most authoritative view until Copernicus demonstrated that it was badly wrong in 1543, so that was a fairly at the time where it was a stable belief. But now try this thought experiment. What will today's cosmologies scientific study look like 2,000 years from now, or even a mere 100 years from now? Today we think about space in three dimensions, latitude or length, longitude or width, and altitude or height. To these we add the fourth dimension, time, because there's not much point in either of that latitude and that longitude if we don't know whether it was last Tuesday or 100 years ago, is it? So we've got to add time in there. And this otherwise reliable view of the world might reign for a very long time indeed, or it might turn out to be rudimentary at best if string theorists are correct. Their theory has it that points in time and space should be more closely defined as strings. So we've got latitude's that way, and longitude's that way, and time, that's that point there. But they're saying, no, you shouldn't think about it as a point, you should think about it in the time, you should think about it as part of a string because it has a continuation or it had something before it. The so-called M theory, which is what that was, proposes 11 dimensions. And I'm not going to list those because I know what they are. Stephen Hawking thought that the M theory is the only candidate for a complete theory of the universe. But these are cosmological theories and not empirical conclusions. Deep water, isn't it? Other prominent physicists think that the string theory fails as a theory of everything. The ascension of Jesus was described by Luke within the context of the imperfect science or understanding of his day, which has since been supplanted by our own imperfect cosmology. Now I'm getting into mighty water. I don't believe that Jesus ascended up in the sense of Mantega's painting or Keith Ward's clever quotation. Although maybe it looked something like that, I find it easier to believe that Jesus may literally exist in another dimension. that is best described symbolically or metaphorically. It's a change of state thing. It's something that we're all familiar with if we like to think about it. If you put a pot of water on the stove, turn the heat on, leave it there, what's going to happen? Turns to steam and it's gone away. It's had a change of state. You put a block of wood on the fire, what happens to it? It gets hot and burns and has a change of state. So things do have changes of states. If you take an aluminium bar and heat it, it will melt. In the symbolic language of the early creeds within the Ascension, Jesus is now exalted at the right hand of the Father. The Ascension is thus about the exaltation of the resurrected Jesus before God, not his elevation to heaven up there. The Ascension is a theological affirmation and not a scientific observation. And with Pentecost next week, the Spirit of God, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, descends like a violent wind and burning fire, which is to say that our Christian story is deeply Trinitarian. I'm not going to argue with that. Our finite language about the Ascension, limited by every cosmology of every age, is necessarily symbolic and metaphorical. It affirms literal realities that are infinite and therefore ultimately indescribable. Sort of another one too, of things that are here and not there. If you're at sea, and you know that you're 200 miles away from North Africa, and suddenly you see a city, what is that? Called a mirage, isn't it? And they're out there in reality, if you should come across them. Shouldn't do this. The Cambridge poet, priest and musician, Malcolm Guite, on his sonnet to you, and it goes like this. We saw his light break through the cloud of glory, while we were rooted still in time and place, as earth became a part of heaven's story, and heaven opened to its human face. We saw him go, and yet we were not part of it. He took us with him to the heart of things, the heart that broke for all the broken heart, his whole, and heaven sent it now, and it sings in the strength that rises out of weakness, sings through the clouds that veil him from our sight, while we ourselves become his clouds of witness, and sing the waning darkness into light. His light in us and ours in him concealed, which all creation waits to see revealed. There's a lot in that to ponder on, and a lot too that's hard to reject. And I hope that all I've said, you may find food for thought.
Ponder on, as we say, the affirmation of faith.
She's on your side.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.